everybody else.
But I pray, can you please help me?
Say, do it yourself.
If I could, I would, but I can't.
I need you.
I need you.
Save.
So we call on
Jai.
He provides for me.
Shield.
He blocked it.
Will.
In the middle of testimony will be that
he did the impossible.
times for no guest, I'm so alone.
No.
Let him bring you out.
bump in the back and stick up the thang. You know that.
New like a beautiful day. New like my love for Shante. New like the gifts I be giving my kids when they open up on Christmas Day.
I mean, everybody, to clap your hands. Sing along with me.
January 30th, 2020, that is the day that my father passed away. So he passed away from COVID. Within the mourning period and just trying to get life back from dealing with that, you know, we decided that we wanted to have a baby. Like, whoo. We find out that we are pregnant on my father's birthday. And when we are about 10 and a half, 11 weeks, we miscarry. It was one of those, we just have to trust that this just wasn't the time. And so once we let go, we started looking for a house. So we were in the market. We bought our house and we're like ready to start celebrating and getting, you know, the house warming together. And the doctor calls and they're like, hey, let's, you know, we never got a zero read on your hormone level. And I want to be able to give you the green light so you guys can start trying again. So when we do the sonogram, the sonogram tech, as soon as she touches me with this machine, you literally see an entire spine across the screen.
Yes.
It was a full baby in there. So we literally had just weeks to prepare for this baby that we thought, you know, we had lost.
We always say he's our miracle child.
Yeah, definitely a living, breathing, in your face miracle. Yes.
So it really helped me understand the power of prayer. And the belief in having faith and never giving up.
Me personally, I wanted to make a public declaration of my faith. One, I've never been baptized. My mom was always very strict and just said, you know, you make the decision when it's time. As an adult, I understand the importance of it, and I wanted to make sure that I did what was right for me. I also want to set that example for my kids.
When I was younger, I got baptized because they told me I was supposed to.
January 30th.
Right path, because it was, and now I'm genuinely getting baptized for me and for my family to rededicate my life fully to God like it's supposed to be in a genuine way. And not just because it was something that I was told when I was younger that I had to get done.
I'm just hoping to gain a deeper connection with God.
Well, what I hope to gain today, honestly, is to continue walking in the faith of the Lord and continue to see the greater blessings that He has for us and understand my full commitment to my Lord and Savior. If you're on the edge of whether you should get baptized or not, trust in God and follow His word, and to lead you down the right path, because your heart is always going to be your true path, because that's where God always touches.
You've already gone through and gone down every other path, so why not see what's on the other side of obedience?
Hey y'all, I'm Nora.
And I'm Brooklyn, and we want to welcome you to our Youth Sunday worship experience. If you are tuning in online, go ahead and share the live with someone and chat with our team in real time.
If this is your first time worshiping with us and you are online, please stay connected. Visit concorddallas.org/connect. And if you are in the building and you are a first-time visitor, we have something special for you. So stop by the Next Steps area located in the foyer on your way out.
Remember that you can give anytime during the service. We have four ways for you to do that. You can scan the QR code, text the word GIVE to 43905, visit concorddallas.org/give, or drop in the boxes throughout the building.
New members, we want to fellowship with you. Meet Pastor Carter and get connected with the other new members and the ministries offered here at Concord happening on April 24th, 2024 in the Legacy Center at 12:45 p.m. right after the second service.
If you are looking for an opportunity to serve, we have one coming up. We need volunteers for the 2024 E.K. Bailey happening July 8th through the 10th. This volunteer moment is just for you. Text SERVE to 43905. Or meet in the foyer inside the Next Steps room immediately after service for more information.
The special bond election early voting begins on Monday, April 22nd through Tuesday, April 30th, and the election day is on Saturday, May 4th.
And for the primary party runoff, early voting begins on Monday, May 20th through Friday, May 24th. Election day is Tuesday, May 28th.
Young adults, meet us at the On the Levee, April 24th at 7 p.m. for the table. There will be a worship, Q&A, and a mixer. And make sure you invite someone to join you.
The Shops at Redbird's newest event is Spring Fest, happening on Saturday, April 27th from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. This family-friendly event will feature music, vibes, food trucks, yard games, interactive attractions, face painting, local foods, and so much more. There's plenty of fun in store, so come out and enjoy everything this exciting event has to offer.
Let's watch this quick video, and then we'll start worship.
Well, I have cousins out here, but I have a godmother. Her cousin lives out here. She's kind of like, so I consider that my family.
I wonder if I'm being awkward right now. Let me try to sit this way. Or maybe this way.
So I'm excited for it, because every single time we've tried.
Dang, I wonder if I got something in my teeth. Let me check my phone real quick.
Nah, I'm good. Look, y'all saw that video? That's awkward. That's called when your intrusive thoughts take over. You overthink. That's not something about to happen over here at the Lincoln Alarm. Let me show y'all what's really about to go down.
Thank you. y'all see that? That's what's really about to happen. Y'all, we about to show up and show out and have some fun. You know, we got urban trivia, a live band, a DJ, and even mocktails. So fellas, go ahead and get registered to sign up, because you already know the ladies did. We got to show up in numbers. So tune in, y'all. We'll see you on the link on the line.
Thank you.
saved your life. Everybody clap your hands. Come on, come on. If he saved your life, if he's picked you up, come on, if he woke you, everybody clap your hands. One more time. Let's do it, say it. You keep on saving my life. You keep on saving my life. Anybody grateful for salvation? You keep on saving my life. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Come on. You keep on saving my life. Come on, if you save the life, everybody clap your hands. Come on, clap your hands. Time, say, hey, you keep on saving my
life.
You keep on saving my life. You keep on saving my life. Over and over, Lord. You put me out, Lord, to put me back in, say. You keep on saving my life. Come on, one more time. Put them hands together. Come on. If you made it to the house of the Lord, you got to activate your prayer. Come on. Somebody lift your voice in this place to give him praise. Anybody glad he saved your life? Thank you, Lord, for rescuing our life. Our God is awesome. He can move mountains. Sing it, church. Keep me. Hide me from. Come on, say, my God.
My God is awesome.
Say, he can keep me.
Heals me when I'm broken.
Strength where I've been weakened.
Strength where I've been weakened.
Forever.
Forever.
Come, let's do it again. Everybody sing, my God.
My God is awesome.
Anybody know he can move mountains? Come on. Keep me in the valley.
Keep me in the valley.
Hide me from the rain.
Hide me from the rain.
Our God is awesome. Say,
my God is awesome.
He heals me when I'm broken.
Strength where I've been
weakened. Come on, say, forever he will reign. Let's go. Come on, church. Say,
my God is awesome.
Come on, anybody believe that? Sing awesome.
Awesome.
Yes, Lord, say awesome. Say
awesome.
Yeah, he's awesome. Yes, Lord,
my God.
Everybody say,
let's do it, say, a healer. What can he do? Say,
he can move mountains.
Keep me in the valley.
Keep me in the valley.
Hide me from the rain.
Hide me from the rain.
Come on, church. Say, my God.
My God is awesome.
He heals me when I'm broken.
Heals me when I'm broken.
Strength where I've been weak.
Strength where I've been weak.
Somebody praise his holy name. Come on, somebody praise his holy name in this place. Somebody praise his holy name in this place. Listen, if you haven't done it yet, you ought to lift your hand and say, thank you, Lord, for who you are. It's not just for what you've done, but for who he is. Come on, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Somebody shout, Jesus. Hallelujah. Clap your hands and give him praise in this place. Hallelujah.
Good morning, Concord. This is, so glad that you all are here to worship with us. You may take your seats. Thank you for coming this morning to spend your Sunday mornings in worship and honor and reverence of our God. I want to bring your attention to a scripture. 2 Corinthians 9 and 6 reminds us that he who sows sparingly will reap also sparingly, but he who sows bountifully will reap how? Bountifully. What does that mean? That simply means you get what you give. Amen. The scripture goes on to say that God is the one that gives seed to the sower. And so God would not command us to give without first giving us something to put in the ground. Isn't that right? And I don't know if you've noticed or not, but Concord is good ground. Is that right? This is a place that helps us to grow and grow and grow, specifically in our next gen department. Our elementary, third, fourth, and fifth graders have been growing in the way of entrepreneurship and marketing. They've even made investment pitches, all in preparation for Lemonade Day, okay? Now, when you come back on May the 5th, you're going to see a bunch of lemonade stands in the area outside. These are lemonade stands that are built by teams of kids, and they're going to be selling you their special unique lemonade recipe, not recipes. They're going to sell you lemonade from what they've come up with for the recipes. They are learning to be entrepreneurs and business leaders at a young age. None of that would be possible without your partnering with us to give. And so we thank you for being so generous to Concord. This is your opportunity now to take a look at the screen and see the different ways that you can give. You can go to our website, concorddallas.org/give. You can also text the word give to 43905, or you can take your offering with you as you leave today and drop it in the receptacle. We invite you to give one of two ways you can give in our general offering where we meet the needs of the mission and vision of our church. You can also give a love offering to our first family as well. And so take your time now. Let's start to give. We are going to pray together. When you're ready, everybody ready? Y'all ain't moving. I see phones. Are y'all good? All right, let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you and praise you this morning because you are good, because you are great, and you are greatly to be praised. We thank you, oh God, for giving seed to the sower. And not just that, God, but giving us fertile ground here at Concord. We can sow that seed and watch it bring forth the harvest for your kingdom. We pray that you would be with us as we give. Help us to give, not of necessity, not grudgingly, because you love a cheerful giver. We cheerfully give today. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, please turn your attention to the screens.
Could have less than I said, go get the chopper. No, I'm a win, I could do this for hours. I got that truth, I got heavenly power. Yeah.
Sometimes we are so much in our feelings that it makes us a little dumb. We have to find a way, like Mary did, to be in our feelings but still be active.
Sometimes you may enter into an assignment that wasn't a God assignment, but that's where Romans 8:28 comes in. All things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and God are called according to his purpose, meaning that he can even use your mistake to put you on the path where he's called you to be.
Through all the lies I knew I was chosen. Walking with God, you thought I was joking. He made a king, you thought I was broken. I went and opened the book.
Darius Daniel says the enemy wants to use agitation to have you abandon your assignment.
Why would I stress about that? Why would I stress about that? Why would I stress about that? Why would I stress about that?
Come on, one more time. Clap your hands if you're glad to be here, everybody. Come on. Come on, do I have any blessed folk in the house? Can I just get at least 50 people? If you're blessed, you ought to stand on your feet right there. If you got food on your table, if you got your family, if you got a roof over your head, if you got the activities of your limbs, come on, let everything that has breath praise be the Lord. Anybody glad you got breath? Come on. Yes, Lord, anybody glad to bless? Where the blessed folk at? Come on, where the blessed folk at? Any blessed people over here? Come on, anybody blessed right here? Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Come on, somebody shout, Lord, bless me. Come on, say, Lord, bless me. Lord, bless me. Lord, bless me. Come on, yes, Lord. Come on, clap your hands right there. Come on. Here we go. Bless me.
Bless me, bless me. Oh, bless me, God.
Clap those hands. I hear you. Sing bless. Around you, let off. Come on, if you bless, you gotta say it. Say, bless me. Hey, come on, say, bless God, not just for me, but everybody. Hey, let all these folks, let's go higher. Say, favor. So everyone around me can say, let all these folks. One more time. Let all these folks. Now, if you want to bless everybody, go crazy. Come on, clap those hands. Clap your hands. Come on, clap. Come on, come on. Here we go, right here. Everybody say,
persecuted, not abandoned.
Criticized, but not forsaken.
We got everything we need.
I got food on my table.
Come
on. I got clothes on my back. I got shoes on my feet. I got a roof over my head. Come on, I can wave my hand. Come on, I can wave my hand.
Come on,
I can move my feet. My God's got everything we need.
Bless
me, bless me.
God, not just for me, but so everyone around me can.
Come on, say, and
all these folks,
you ought to look down your row,
and all these folks,
God, now look at somebody and say, you're blessed. Come on, look at them, tell you're blessed. I see you, come on, tell somebody you're blessed. Blessed in the field, blessed when we come, blessed when we go. Come on, anybody blessed in this place? Yes, Lord, if you got the activity on you, if you're breathing, you're blessed. If you woke up this morning, you're blessed. You have the opportunity to come in church and lift your hand and tell them, thank you, Lord, for blessing me. Hallelujah. Bless me, Jesus. Bless my children. Come on, y'all. Bless your parents. Come on. Bless, bless, bless. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And since it's in the blessing business, anybody grateful for grace in this place? Anybody grateful for God's grace? Lord, you can bless me with material things, but Lord, I want your grace. Come on, anybody want his grace? We already talked about his favor. Anybody want your favor to fall over you? His grace, Lord, right now, do it in the name of Jesus. Somebody said, thank God for grace. Lord, we want your unmerited favor. Oh, Lord, come on, just thank him for his grace. If you want, you ought to say, Lord, I want your grace. Lord, I need your grace. Do it right now for my family, Lord. Grace, grace, grace. Hallelujah. Anybody need his grace? Come on, anybody need it? Let's do it. Say, I need it. Say,
I need it. Your grace.
Than I thought I ever would.
Than I thought I ever.
Yes, Lord.
You forgave.
Than I thought you ever could.
Than I thought you ever.
You ever could. I was. Stronger in my head, Lord. But the truth is, come on, if you need his grace, you ought to slip your hands right there and say, Lord,
I need.
Let's go.
Grace.
Come on, this is your moment. Tell him what you need. Lord, please accept my apology. I need your grace. Come on, sing grace.
Anybody need the Lord's grace in your life? Yes. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Father, we come to you right now and we declare we need your grace. We declare that we cannot make it without you. We declare that you are the health and strength. You are everything that we have. So, Father, we just thank you, God. It was grace that woke us up this morning. It was grace that got us started. It was grace that has given us the activity of our limbs. It was grace that paid our bills. It was grace that got us through school. It was grace that allowed us to retire. It was grace that has kept us all these years. It was grace that has given us a chance to worship your name. It was grace that allowed us to have a relationship with you when you sent your son to die on a cross for our sins. We didn't earn it. We didn't deserve it. As a matter of fact, we were disqualified. But by your grace, you sent a son that would die on our behalf, and we say thank you. It's by grace that we're saved, and not of works, lest any man boast. So, Father, we say thank you that we are living on grace. Grace woke us up. Grace strengthens us, and grace will get us through tomorrow. We honor your name. We thank you for this next generation singing songs of praise to you. We thank you, Lord. This is what Big Mama prayed for. This is what Grandma, this is what Grandpa said I wanted to see. And so, Lord, we thank you, Lord, that we are living on the prayers, on the seeds planted generations ago. We love you and we honor you and we praise your name. It's in your son Jesus' name that we say this prayer, and all of God's people said, amen. Come on, let's celebrate today. Come on, celebrate these young people as they return back. Come on, let's celebrate them, celebrate them, celebrate them. Amen, amen, amen. We thank God that we are a church of many generations. And we thank God for these young people just singing their hearts out on today. Because that's our future, family. That's our future. Some of you knew what that was like when your Sunday came. And you got up there and sang, Jesus loves all the little children. You got up there and saying, yes, Jesus loved me. And you got your little hymn book together and you were singing that song. But this is the next rendition. They are standing on the shoulders of what we prayed for, what we asked God for. Now they are worshiping and loving God, and we thank God for how God is using them. Amen. 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 Family, we are so good to see you on this morning. We thank you for being here on today. I was so glad it rained yesterday and not today, because I said, listen, you know how we act when rain show up. So I was like, Lord, thank you for Saturday, not Sunday. So I am so grateful. I mean, it rained all day long. And I said, ooh, please. So we are grateful that you are here on this morning. But even in the rain, we were still doing ministry. We fed over 500 seniors, came through our drive-through fish fry. It is the highlight of the year. I want to thank Pastor Williams and his team for the way they served and ministered to so many of our seniors who came out in the inclement weather so we could love on them and bless them with a fish plate. Amen. Chicken plate and a fish plate is always in order in the black church. They are staples. Has to be on the menu. And we are thankful for yesterday. We had a great, great, great time. All right, family. We also are baptizing today. Let me see. I want to make sure I share this with you. We are so excited. I don't want to make sure I miss it. Make sure I got the note here. We baptized close to 30 people on today. Half this service. Woo! Incredible, incredible, incredible. I don't think they're back in the service yet, but we are so proud of them and so excited for all the decisions God continues to make in life of our church. All right, family, if you got your Bibles, meet me in James chapter 3. James chapter 3, we have been making our way through the book of James, and we are about halfway through James chapter 3. I want to read for you, friends, the first 12 verses of that particular chapter, James chapter 3. Verses 1 through 12, and it reads this way. Not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways, and anyone who is never at fault of what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. And when we put bits in the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal, or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire and a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and it itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals and birds and reptiles and sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's image. Out of the same mouth comes praise and cursing. or cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. Amen, amen, amen. You may take your seats. As you take your seats, would you tell your neighbor good morning next to you? Tell him good morning. Tell him good morning. Don't tell him that's you in the passage. That's you in the passage. Don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. All right, family. For a few moments, I want to share from the subject of watch your mouth. Watch your mouth. I started serving on staff when I was 25. It was August of 2020, Pastor Bailey, 2000, that Pastor Bailey, our founding pastor, invited me to join on staff, and I was overjoyed absolutely at the privilege to serve on staff. About 2 years I've served on staff, he then asked me to become the assistant pastor as well as his successor. Super excited about that opportunity and began serving in that role. And on one occasion, there was a leadership meeting that happened on Saturday. And he said to me, Brian, I need you to ask this individual to come to that meeting because we're announcing their new role. And so the meeting came, he wasn't there, and Pastor then asked me, where is he? And I said, he couldn't make it. That was part of the, well, he couldn't make it because I never invited him in the first place. And so the next day, Sunday, he then came to me and said, Brian, I asked him, and he said, you never invited him to come. And I said, I lied. I apologize. And he said these words to me. He said, Brian, don't make me have to question your integrity. And after I picked up my face up off the floor, I began to realize something in that moment, that our words matter. I was trying to be impressive. I didn't want to make mistakes. New role, new opportunity, young. And I made the mistake of lying to my boss, and subsequently had him help. He held me accountable. And that was a moment when I realized that your words really matter. But all of us know what that's like. We all have had moments where we have had to learn that what you say, what you don't say, how you say it, who you say it to, who you don't say it to, all of those things shape your life. They shape our relationships. They shape our friendships. They shape our partnerships. They shape our business. They shape a church. They shape a family. That your words and how we talk to others and how we treat others and how we communicate, they are really the foundation for all of our relationships. Any relationship that is of substance is based on good communication. And so it's no surprise that James, the author of this letter, as he begins to try and capture how we ought to live out our faith more fully, it's no surprise that right in the middle of the letter, he would spend these verses, 12 verses, but he actually uses more verses in the life of the chapter to keep reminding us and to show us that your faith ought to show up in your words. That your words and the words you use and the words you connect and how you talk to people and whether you speak the truth or whether you speak lie, that all of those things shape our faith, that our faith has to flow through our words. And so I hope today we all lean in to today's passage, because there's not a person in this room that can't grow in the area of their communication. Matter of fact, there's no one that ever fully arrives and ever has it all together. All of us have work to do in order to be who God has called us to be in terms of how we talk and connect with others. Here's the first principle out of the text. My words are a measure of my maturity. My words are a measure of my maturity. I want you to catch this, friends, in verses 1 and 2. He literally says this. He says in verse 2, he says, listen to this. He says, if you can control your words, you can control your whole life. He's trying to help us to understand that Matthew 15 and 18 says, it's not the things that you put in the mouth, but it's the things that come out of your mouth. That your mouth is a reflection of your heart. So if we can control our words, then in turn, we can control our entire lives. He said it all starts there. Just like a thermometer tells the temperature of the room, the words that you use, the things you post on social media, the things you put in text messages, all of those things indicate and shape who you are. Like a car that has a dashboard, he says your words are the dashboard of your life, and they indicate where your spiritual life is. Now, can you imagine that the health of your life, like there are gauges on the dashboard, there are also gauges on your life. There's a meter that talks about how many lies you told. There's a meter that talks about how much encouragement did you give away. How much criticism did you give? How much gossip did you get engaged in? If you can control your words, you can control your whole life. Here's the next one, friends. Our words are powerful, so be careful. Our words are powerful. Look at verses 3 and 4. He says this, your words may seem small, but they are not insignificant. He says your words are so powerful that they are like the small 2 inches or 3-inch bit that goes in a horse's mouth. But they can control a horse over 1,000 pounds. That a huge ship has a small rudder, but that rudder shapes the life of that entire ship. And he comes and tells us that your words are so powerful. So he says, be cautious with your words, because they're small, but they make a big impact. Proverbs 18:21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. But you and I can't underestimate how significant our words are, because the words that we have a great impact on those around us, either for good or also can be used for bad. Here's the next one, friends. Our words can be destructive, so be constructive. He gets around verses 5 and 6, and he uses the analogy about the tongue. He says it is full of evil. He says it's like a forest fire. That tongue can set a spark and set the whole forest on fire. If you've watched any time over the summer months, often in California, there's always fires that come about. One of them that happened in September 2020 was the consequence of a family having a gender reveal, and the spark happened and ended up burning 23,000 acres of land, all from one spark. He says the same thing can happen with my tongue and your tongue. We can say one thing, and that one spark can either build something or it can break something. He goes on to say this. Here's the next one, friends. Our words are uncontrollable, so be controlled by the Spirit. You get down to verse 7, and he says it's a restless evil. He says it this way. You've seen all kinds of people train all kinds of animals. Text says you can train animals, you can train birds, you can train reptiles, you can even train sea creatures. But he says that tongue, it can't be trained. That tongue always wants to get into something, wants to start something, wants to say something, wants to share what it heard, wants to share what it thought, wants to share its opinion. He puts it this way in verse 8. He says, it's a restless evil full of deadly poison. Oh, this is rough, y'all. This is hard, but he's trying to help us to understand. He says, no man or woman can control the tongue. No matter how hard you try to do it, no matter how much you think you got it under control, he says, no man, no woman is able to control the tongue. That tongue, he said, is so restless, it's so deadly, it can't be controlled by anyone. So what's our hope if we can't control it? What he's trying to help us to understand is that you can't control it in your own strength, but you're going to have to depend on God to be able to give you the strength to be able to control your tongue. He's trying to tell us that tongue can betray us so quickly that it's going to require us leaning on God, leaning on the Holy Spirit. Here it is, Lord, guide my tongue as I go to work on today. Lord, guide my tongue as I have this conversation. Lord, guide my tongue, keep me as I get in the middle of this. Lord, give me the words to say. Give me the right tone to use. Tell me when to stop and not go too far. Tell me how to say, give me the right timing so I find the right time. He's saying, friends, you and I cannot control our tongues and do it on our own. We need God every single day to guide our hearts, to guide our words, and to guide our thoughts. See, the reason you need God is because words are not just words. Words are a reflection of our hearts. Sometimes people that lash out, it ain't even about you. It's not even have anything to do with you. But sometimes people can have stuff in their heart, in their mind, and they just lash out because that's the kind of person or the kind of season they may be going through. So correcting the words ain't always the easy part. Sometimes you got to get to the heart. Why am I so angry? Why am I always frustrated? Why do I always think everybody's against me? Why do I take everything personal? Sometimes you got to have a heart change before you can have your words change. And that's why he's saying you got to ask God to do that. Oh, friends, listen, he's trying to help you to understand only God can turn a cusser into a praiser. Only God can turn a gossip into a good friend. Only God can take a liar and make them a friend that you can depend on. Only God can do that. You can't do it in your own strength, your own willpower. You need Jesus' power and Holy Spirit power. You got to be filled with the Holy Spirit so he can change your tongue, your attitude, and your heart. Only God can do it. He's saying you got to learn how to lean and depend on God. You got to make it a matter of prayer on a regular basis. God, help me. Here's the last one, friends, and then I want to give you some ways to apply this in our lives. The last one is this. Is our words can be inconsistent, so be consistent. He gets down to that section 9 through 12. And he just calls us out. He says, listen, how you go praise God one moment and then pronounce cursing on the human beings that look in his image? And cursing in this one, this is not cussing. It's closely related. Cussing is one thing. This cursing in the text is to pronounce something evil or wrong upon someone. All right, I want you to get to, they're all cousins, but I want you to understand this is different than what's in the text, right? What he is saying is that how can we just be going back and forth all the time? He said it don't make sense. He says in nature you'll never see an apple tree carrying oranges. He said it's unnatural. It doesn't make sense, and so he's calling us away from this. He's telling us all of us will be tempted to be bilingual. Some of us have been bilingual a long time. And I'm not talking about Spanish and English. There's another level of bilinguality that we can carry. And he's saying that should not be so. He's saying there ought to be some consistencies in how we communicate and how we talk and how we use our words. There should be some consistency in our lives. Let me use the rest of our message to give you two lifts. Here's the first one. I want to give you some habits to apply when it comes to the tongue. Let me give you five ways that can help us to honor this passage in our lives. Here's the first one, truth. Somebody say truth. We've got to learn to speak the truth. If you and I want to use our tongues well, we have to make sure that we speak the truth. Ephesians 4:15 says, instead speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become respect and mature of him who is the head and the head of Christ. Speaking the truth, what's that mean? That means that we ought to speak honestly, openly, and transparently. It means you got to be honest about your feelings, got to be honest about your actions, be honest about your mistakes. You can't just say, what's wrong, nothing. You got to be honest, say, no, this is what happened. I feel hurt about this, or I feel excited about this, or I feel frustrated about this, or I feel a little fearful about this. It's only in us sharing, it's only in us communicating, it's only when we share our hearts that we really can connect with people. If we, it's the truth. The truth is the foundation for which we can build long-lasting relationships. Truth. Not only truth, here's the next one, being kind in our conversation. It really means, the other word you can put here is being positive. I love the way Ephesians 4:29 puts it. He says, don't let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up. I love that phrase. He says, our conversation should be helpful. It should be that which helps to build others up, right? He says it needs to be in such a case that we can build up others, we can strengthen others. It needs to be helpful. Phrases like thank you. Phrases like I appreciate you. Phrases like are you okay? Phrases that say, hey, help me to understand. Or I forgive you, or I apologize, or what can I do to help? These are all, or I'm sorry. These are all phrases that are kind phrases that help us to be able to connect and love on each other. And they help us live in our faith because kindness is sourced in God because he's been so kind to us. There's a popular restaurant chain that we all know that is incredible, that is known for their kindness. Matter of fact, when you finish your order, they also often say, my pleasure. Because it's something about how Chick-fil-A and kindness has been connected together, that their customer service, it always elevates the experience. And it helps you, because here's the thing that business people know. Business people know you can make money when you're kind to people. Because you'll get returning clients and you'll get referrals. And because how you treat people helps you know whether or not they'll come back or not. Friends, the same thing applies to us in our Christian lives. If we're going to reflect our faith and the God we serve well, then the words we say got to be words that reflect what Jesus would say. And it is kindness that goes so far. God, help me to be positive in my language, kind in my language. Help me to be known as an encourager of people. Because here's the reality. Everybody around you is walking around with a cup that needs to be filled to help remind them that God has a purpose and plan for their lives. And our prayers, God ought to use you every single day. You ought to be walking around trying to find people you can uplift and encourage, because that's what God does for you. Here's another way you and I got to use our words: respectful. Everyone that we meet is made in the image of God, that we never have a right to look down on somebody because of their background or what their possessions or anything. No, we, as we said a couple of Sundays ago, the ground is level at the foot of the cross. Not one of us is better than somebody else. We all carry dignity and value. Whether someone is homeless on the street or the CEO of a company, we all are equal in the eyes of God. We all carry value, so we got to talk to people with respect. We got to treat people and speak to them with respect. We got to see that person with genuine care and concern and empathy. And we got to imagine ourselves in their position. That's the only way we really can talk to people and honor people and speak to people in the appropriate way. Here's another one: listening, listening, listening. I love James chapter 1, verse 19, where James says this: my dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to be angry. Notice the order with which he puts that in. He says, first of all, be quick to listen. We live in a world where it's hard sometimes to find somebody that'll listen to us. It's hard sometimes to find somebody that will look us in the eye, puts down the phone, stops texting, stops watching TV, and just looks at us and hears our heart and hears us really. Not rolling their eyes, not making faces, but listen, not thinking about what I'm going to say to retaliate against you, but hearing you aren't. Listen, one of the best things you can do to improve your relationships, to build better relationships, is to learn how to be a good listener and to lean in and hear people. That's exactly what James said. He says, be quick to listen. Sometimes it's our listening that influences the whole relationship because we didn't hear that person in the first place. And here's the last tool you need in your toolbox: silence. Somebody say silence. Oh, that's a good tool to keep in your toolbox, your word toolbox. When the text says you ought to be, James 1:19, he says, be slow to speak. Proverbs 10:19 says, sin is not ended by multiplying words, but the prudent hold their tongues. Oh, man, sometimes you just got to stop talking so much. Sometimes we got to stop talking to the wrong people. Sometimes we got to say, Lord, give me some discernment. Give me some discretion because I don't want to go too far. Give me the right people to talk to. Help me to know when enough is enough. We've all been there, have we not? Where we just, it was just one sentence too much. We've all been there and we said, oh, if I could have just held that back. Sometimes the greatest tool that we have is to not say nothing at all. Just keep on moving, keep on walking, how you doing, and keep on making your move. Because sometimes silence can be a tool that God wants us to use in wisdom. All right, friends, let me close by giving you the habits to avoid. I gave you five habits that you can utilize to be able to leverage, to be able to impact others. Those are the five tools that we want to use every single day. Every single day, we ought to be leveraging, talking to people with respect, speaking the truth, speaking positive, finding not to say too much. But then there are five ways, too, that we want to avoid. Here's the first one. You knew this was coming. Number one is lying. All of us have had that moment, right, where the pressure was there or whatever the case may be. But lying is happened so much that we live in a world that's always faking everything. People lie on their resumes, lie on their taxes, lie on their jobs, lie about their time, lie on their expense reports. People lie with fake boyfriends and fake girlfriends. I mean, people lie at work, lie at home, lie at church. People lie all the time. And he's saying to us that lying doesn't fit who we are. He's saying that lying is anytime you try to intentionally mislead somebody. Sometimes we lie so much we end up lying about the lie because we can't remember what we told the first time. They did a study and they found out that by age 4, 90% of children have already figured out the concept of lying. And then it follows us from day to day. One study said that 60% of adults can't have a 10-minute conversation without lying at least once. Now, that other study said that men lie 6 times a day and women lie 3 times. I don't know if that's right. I don't agree. I disagree. I should have skipped over that one. That's somebody said, I knew it. Somebody, they said the number one lie told was, nothing's wrong, I'm fine. Yeah. And so all of us have to figure out how we can speak the truth. We got to speak the truth and live in the truth. So many times we lie to try to protect our image, protect who we are, protect how people view us. But the truth of the matter is that we're going to connect better with people when they know who we really are. When they know that we are human, that we make mistakes, that we have challenges, that we have issues, because sin loves to live in dark places. And even if we can't tell the truth to a certain person, find somebody we can confide in, we can talk to, we can be accountable for. But if we're going to be the men and women God has called us to be, we got to avoid lying at all costs. Here's the next one, not only lying, but anger and bitterness. Anger and bitterness. Ephesians 4:31 says, get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, and brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice. Whenever you and I resort to anger and bitterness, we really are in a dangerous place. Unfortunately, we live in a world where it's modeled in every place. All of these crazy reality TV shows and all the other stuff that we see, the culture more and more is moving to a place where there is anger and name-calling and fussing and fighting like this is going to solve our problems. But many of us in the room know this doesn't make our problems better. It often makes our problems worse. If you always on the 10, it can't be everybody else. If you always coming in hot, it can't be everybody in the world. There's got to be something else that's happening on a deeper basis that you're going to have to work on, because God doesn't want you angry at the entire world. God doesn't want you using anger to try to solve all your problems. Sometimes it creates more problems. We get in legal issues and other things. We lose our jobs. We lose relationships because nobody wants to be around a person that always is lashing out, or that's how they solve their problems. Instead, as a follower of Christ, he's calling us to learn how to deal with these, to sometimes take a time out, regroup ourselves before we know things are going too far. to sometimes wait until we calm down before we decide to have that conversation, to sometimes need to get counseling to try to figure out what's happening in my life, that sometimes maybe there's our unforgiveness or grudges that continue to eat away at me that are keeping me from being who God has called me to be. Here's another tool that you need to keep in your toolbox. It is criticism and gossip. Criticism and gossip. Boy, some people have the gift of criticism. They just seem to find the negative in any situation. For whatever reason, everything could be perfect, but they have the gift of coming in the room and deflating the whole room, or as some would say, killing the whole vibe in the room. Because whatever reason, they just keep finding negativity. They just keep nitpicking and picking on everything. It's her birthday, and yet you gotta criticize her outfit. You gotta bring the attention to you. You gotta reset the room. God, this is not of God. God never gave this spirit. Matter of fact, Philippians 4:8 says, "Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent, praiseworthy, think about those things." This criticism, we gotta stop being the one that just criticizes. It's okay with holding people accountable, that's one thing. But being critical is to constantly demean and discourage somebody else, to beat them down. We all know what that's like because some of us have lived and faced those situations, and nothing good from that. The cousin to criticism is gossip. Where you always think you gotta spill the tea, you always think, you don't know, but guess what I heard? You always feel like you in the know, you got your own personal shade room account. You just wanna share and promote. You wanna be the one, right? But here's what we gotta realize: every dog that brings a bone will carry a bone. The same person gossiping about somebody else, they will also gossip about you. We don't want to be that person. That doesn't fit who we are. Two more friends and I'm done. When we talk to people, we got to make sure we get rid of the habit of disrespect. When we disrespect people with our tone or our demeanor or our attitude or our words, then we put that person into a corner. And what we give out is exactly what we go get. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about because you said, "Listen, I was doing good till they came at me the way they came at me." And if that's what you want, then that's what you're going to get, right? I mean, it is what it is. Like, if you're going to come at me that way, listen, I tried. I tried to hold my tongue, but you said one too many things. Disrespect always brings the worst out of people. It doesn't make a difference. All of us have this intrinsic value that God has put in us, and it brings something out. Matter of fact, they only have to be disrespectful to you. You can just watch them be disrespectful to somebody else, and you go jump in and solve it for them, because that's just how you roll. You're like, "Listen, I can't take it. I can't take no kid talking to their mama crazy, talking to their teacher crazy." You're like, "Look, I can't take it. I can't." That's why you're not teaching school, because your fuse is just not where it needs to be. You'd be locked up somewhere trying to hold a kid up. Boy, I told you. So you're not ready. But disrespect, right? It brings something out of us. And so you and I have to understand that we can't disrespect people. We can't do it, because when we do it, ultimately it's always going to set the wrong stage. Here's the last tool that we got to avoid using. It's the tool of silence. I know silence was on both lists, but this is the silence that means the silent treatment. It's when we take silence and we weaponize it to hurt somebody. It's when we take silence and we use it to ignore a person, or we use it to punish a person or to hurt a person. It's when we go silent either on certain relationships or even in a marriage context or even in a friendship context. Yes, sometimes you need to be silent, but other times we weaponize it to use it to hurt somebody. It's when you're in a married relationship and you start playing the silent game. And you start playing it for one day after another day. My wife and I struggled with this when we were early in our marriage. And you know what's crazy about playing the silent game is that you can play it so well that you can be silent and icing the other person. And then the phone rings, "Hey, how you doing? You doing good?" "Yeah, I'm doing good. And then you ice them all over again like they're not even in the room. It's crazy that you can become so petty that you can find ways to try to push certain buttons. You can find a way to try to poke at them. You can find a way to try and intimidate them. This is a dangerous game. Nobody wins in this. Nobody wins. And I'm not talking about relationships where somebody has hurt you and you've decided to put some boundaries in place to protect you. That's a whole different thing, because sometimes you do need boundaries in your life with certain relationships when that relationship is toxic or when that relationship is not headed in the right direction. This is different. This is when you being silent and being petty just so you can be petty and get back at the other person. Friends, I wanted to give you a game plan. I didn't want to cover James 3 without giving you a game plan today of these five habits you want to cultivate in your life, and five habits to avoid, that if we do these, we can honor God well in our lives. A poet once wrote these words: a careless word may kindle strife. A cruel word may wreck a life. A bitter word may hate and steal. A brutal word may smite and kill, but a gracious word may smooth the way. A joyous word may light the day. A timely word may lessen stress, and a loving word may heal and bless. Friends, you and I must know there is power in the words that we use, and you and I must choose to use that power responsibly. That God wants to heal you. God wants to guide you. God wants to take your relationships to a whole new place, your career, your walk with Him, your family, your friendships. But it all starts with our words, and your words set the course. I close by telling you, our children at one point had a chance to attend this camp. And at the end of the camp, they had this thing called affirmations. And at the end of the camp, I remember our daughter was there, and they called her forward, her counsel for the week, and began to walk her through some affirmations that they said they saw in her. And here the counsel said, I see in you aspiring, that you have goals and you have dreams, and I've seen the way that you aspire others. I see in you joyfulness. There's a joy in you that can't be quenched. Every morning when I watched you get up, as I watched you interact with other cabin mates, you always had a joy in you. And then she said, you have an authenticity, that there is an authenticity about you, that there is something about you that is authentic and real and genuine and valuable. And I sat there and watched as that young lady called those values out of the life of our daughter. And I thought to myself, wow, you saw all that in 1 week. And I was blown away at how powerful it was for her to call out of our daughter what we also saw in her. But I thought to myself, what would happen if every day you had somebody in your life that was calling out of you what God had already put in you? What would happen if you had a family member or a friend or a coworker that was calling out of you and celebrating you and affirming you for the uniqueness that God is doing in us? So many times we hold back instead of sharing with other people and using our words to build people up. It's easy to see what's wrong, but sometimes God has said, I want you to see what's right. See what's happening right. See what's happening positive. See the progress and celebrate what God is doing even now for what He's going to do later. Friends, I want to invite you to join for me just a moment right now. I want to give you an opportunity to do just what we've talked about in today's sermon. If you've got your phone nearby, I want to invite you right now to text a message of encouragement and to use your words to at least two people. Just grab your phone if you can. I want you to text encouragement to two people. Or maybe it's something that you need to say, listen, I just want to apologize for something. I'm going to talk to you more later, but I was thinking about you in today's sermon, and I just wanted to text you. If you'll do that, I want you to text at least two people and just use your words right now to call out of what God is doing, to affirm what God is doing. Or maybe it's a correction. It's saying, man, you know, I missed the mark. I shouldn't have said that. I lied about something. I need to correct something. My tone was off. But I want you to give you right now a couple of moments. Would you text two people in your life in your relationships, maybe a church member, maybe a family member, maybe a co-worker, but I want you to do that right now. Do that right now. And then once you've sent those two messages, I just want you to take a couple moments of prayer and say, Lord, I just want to help me to use my words in a way that brings you glory and honor. Guide my tongue, guide my heart. Use me, Lord. So text those two people. And then when that's done, I just want you to spend a couple moments in prayer right where you are, just asking, Lord, to use you. Use your tongue, use your words. Guide you, direct you, lead you. Ask the Lord for healing in a relationship where words have done some great damage. Ask the Lord for restoration and direction. Yes. Father, we come in this room, even this very moment, and we come and we thank you, Lord, for the joy and the opportunity to use our words in a way that honors you and brings you glory. But first of all, Lord, we come and we just confess. We confess, Lord, because all of us know there have been moments when we've missed the mark with our words. We come right now, Lord, just confessing the times in which we have missed it. The time when we've said too much, the time when we've been involved in lying or gossip, the times, God, where we have missed the mark for you. So, Father, we come right now, Lord, confessing those sins to you. And now, oh, Lord, we ask you, Lord, would you guide us? Would you direct us? Thank you for your word today that challenges us, Lord, to be different than where we used to be. And so, Father, right now, Lord, help our words to be words that build people up. Help our words to be words that speak the truth in love. Help our words to be words, Lord, that are positive. Help our words to be words that give people the feedback. Lord, help our words to be words, Lord, that are respectful. So, Father, we put it all in your hands right now, and we say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you don't give up on us, Lord, but you keep working in us. So even right now, we pray for those two people that we text or the two conversations that we'll have later. We pray right now, God, that you will continue to use us, that you'll continue to bring restoration, that you'll continue to bring healing. And Lord, we especially thank you right now for those people in our lives that you have sent that has been wind beneath our wings. We thank you right now for the people that you sent into our lives that have been the very people that have been the joy and the strength that we've needed in life. Thank you for those, Lord, that have encouraged us. Thank you for those that have called out of us that which we didn't even see in our own selves. Thank you for those that encouraged us. Thank you for those that have built us up. Thank you for those that remind us of your promises. Thank you for those that didn't give up on us. We celebrate those people that you sent into our lives, and we treasure them and we value them, and we say amen and praise your name for those that you sent. Father, we honor your name today. And Father, as we close, we say, Lord, we need you. We can't do this without you. We need you every single day. We need you in our families. We need you as our businesses. We need you at work. We need you in our extended family. We need you in every way, Lord. So Father, we say thank you in advance for what you are doing. I thank you, Lord, that in this room there are testimonies of lives you've already changed. In this room, there is healing happening in relationships. In this room, Lord, we all know it starts right here. So, Father, we thank you in advance for what you've done, for what you're doing, and for what you are going to do. It is in the name of Jesus that we say this prayer, and all of God's people said amen. Come on and give God glory in this room. He's worthy. Would you stand with me, family, all over the room? As you stand together right now, please don't walk during this important time. Somebody in this room, it's time for you to make a decision to say yes to Jesus Christ. If you're in this room and you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, if you're in this room and you have thought about it, but you've always put up barriers before saying yes, today is the day when you can say yes to Jesus Christ and choose him as your Lord and Savior. The Bible says this, you ain't got to get yourself together. No, you come just as you are and he will give you a new beginning. Also in this room, you don't have a church family. You already given yourself to the Lord, but you don't have a place where you can worship regularly. You're not connected to a local church. We would love to have you as a part of our church family. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ and you want to do that, if you've got questions and you want to get those questions answered, or if you need a church family, would you gather your belongings right where you are and begin to meet me right here at this altar? I'm going to pray with you, and then we'll walk you out and teach you how to take your next step with Christ. If that's your story, would you grab your belongings right now, begin to make your way here? We just want to pray with you because we can't wait to see what God has in store as our music ministry comes. That's your cue to grab your belongings and begin to make your way here. We're looking forward to you. Come on. Anybody today want to say yes to Jesus Christ? Come on, I see you.
Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Yes, yes, yes.
Strength, welcome, like welcome, no other.
Welcome, welcome, my brother, my sister.
Strength, welcome, like, yes, no other.
Come on, come today, come today.
And it reaches to me.
Yes.
Come on, say you are, say
you are my strength.
I see you. Come today, come today.
Strength like no other.
Yes, yes, yes. Time. Family, we are so excited for your decision to say yes to Jesus Christ. We celebrate you giving him your yes. We celebrate this new beginning. We celebrate this new day. Let me pray with you. Father God, I come right now and I want to tell you thank you, Lord. Thank you for their yes to you. We celebrate, Lord, their new beginning. We celebrate this fresh start. And so now, Lord, would you lead them? Would you guide them? Would you order their steps? We celebrate, Lord, you are doing a new thing in their lives today. And Lord, you are letting us witness it. Would you bless their lives, bless their families, bless their relationships, bless their future, bless their professional life. Lord, would you bless every avenue of their lives? Lord, give them the faith, give them the strength, give them the encouragement, give them the anointing on your lives to walk and trust you for every decision and everything in their lives. We honor you, Lord. We bless your name and we praise your name. It's in your son Jesus' name that we say this prayer and all of God's people said amen. Come on, family, let's celebrate them one more time. Let's celebrate them one more time. Give God praise for these decisions on today. Welcome, welcome, my family. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We're delighted that you're here. God bless you. All right, family, let's, can you please be seated at this time? A couple of things we want to do, and then we'll be dismissed on today. The first thing I want to do this morning is I want to take a moment to recognize someone that has served so faithfully in our city for this past season. He has been incredibly instrumental in numerous ways. I wanted to take a moment just to call out a couple of the ways in which his leadership has impacted our city and community. He was the first to develop Dallas's first racial equity plan, a citywide guide to help address disparities in neighborhood infrastructure, racial wealth gaps, and other inequities. He was the first individual to establish a homelessness office. He was the first to be able to hire our city's first black female police chief in Chief Renee Hall, hired our first Hispanic police chief in Brother Eddie Garcia. He created the largest bond package in the city's history of $1 billion. He has been a transformational leader who also enhanced transparency in the public square, served for the past 7 years. Friends and family, would you please help me to honor at this time T.C. Broadnex. We want to thank you for these 7 years and in the immense ways that God has used you to help better the city of Dallas. You have led us through a major season, through COVID. You helped address so many inequities in our city. Thank you for leading an incredibly challenging role, but God has used you significantly. Our blessings are with you as you head to Austin. But again, we want to say to you congratulations and thank you for your 7 years of service to the city of Dallas. Thank you so very much.
Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Praise God, praise God. Listen, I want to thank you, Pastor, and thank everyone in this audience today. Whether you knew who I was or not, I just wanted you to understand and appreciate the fact that I was fighting for you every day as I led this city. The southern part of our city, I don't need to speak about all the challenges and the history here in this city. That was one of the things that made me want to come and be the city manager in this city, to tackle those challenges and to make a difference and find a way to point us in a direction as a city that we can never turn away from, and that is around providing equity and encouragement and bridging all the gaps that have existed for so long in this community. And so the support that I've received, and I wouldn't be able to do all this without the most important person in my life that walks this earth, and that is my wife, Andrea Broadnax. Can you stand up? Now, you need to stand up. I know you don't want to stand up. And my two young children who are here as well this morning, can y'all stand up? This right here, I'm sure you understand. I didn't get to spend as much time over these last 7 years with them that I wanted to because I was working as many hours as I could to find ways to improve this city. But without them to come home to and to wake up to, I wouldn't have been able to do this work. And so as I leave this city, please, please continue to hold the city accountable. Make us as a city be better every day. And there is no better way to do that than to find a way to support Kimberly Beiser Tolbert. I'm gonna ask her to stand up. Deputy City Manager Kimberly Beiser Tolbert, in the next week and a half, will take the reins of the city as the interim city manager. I've told people, thank you. She joined this courageous walk with me the very next day after I started on my first day. And the only reason it was the day after is because I didn't want her to outshine me on the first day. But I've told everybody, and I will not be bashful, without her in City Hall with me these last 7 years, as well as another young lady, Leah Cidio Pereira. Go ahead and stand up right here. Without these two women by my side, and Liz gets the most credit and should for navigating the city's first racial equity plan, period. Just so you know. But I say this about Kimberly. She will be better than me if she gets the opportunity. She's made me better. She will lead this city in the right direction. So if you've got a phone, if you've got a email, find ways at some point in time in the future to send your support for her, because she's going to fight for you more than I fought, better than I fought, in a spirit much more guided in the meaning of equity and inclusion, because she's been on the front line. So again, thank you. God bless you. I pray for you all. Pray for me. And thank you for this.
Amen, 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 amen. We are so thankful. Thank you for your season of service and leadership. Thank you so much. We are grateful indeed. So keep them in prayers. You know how much we love and pray for you, and we are prayful and thankful for what the Lord has in store, but thank you for your service and leadership as well. All right, family, a couple quick things. We want to make sure you, early voting starts on tomorrow. $1.25 billion available through 10 bond propositions. Make sure you get out to vote. All of these are important issues. 3/4 of that goes to public safety and streets, as well as some of our parks. But this is all the infrastructure that's needed to address some of the issues in our community. So make sure you get out to vote. Also, Mark Cooks is running for mayor of Duncanville. Early voting also starts tomorrow. I saw Mark earlier. There he is. Mark, thank you so much for your leadership. Faithful servant leader, both in our church and this community, so keep them in prayers. Dr. Keisha Riley is running for Dallas College Board of Trustees, District 7, another faithful member and volunteer that is now stepping into public space. Our prayers are with you. And then Shirley Robinson running for DeSoto City Council, Place 6. Where's Shirley? Amen. There she is. So prayers for her as well. So family, wanted you to be mindful of all those things that are happening in the life of our church. We hope you have a great, great week. Again, thank you to everybody that came out for the fish fry. Thank you for letting us love on you and care for you in the inclement weather. We love our seniors in the life of our church. Let's stand, family. We're going to get ready to be dismissed at this time.
All right, family. Want to go through a couple baby dedications on today, so we want to celebrate Taylor and Zachary Jackson, who are dedicating their daughter, Karis Teagan Jackson. Yep, y'all can praise God for that. Yep.